morning, I'm going to very briefly discuss how we can use this mapper with high level, in this case we could say their high school or A levels or even first year undergraduate students to test physics works. So, this has been done in collaboration with the University of Coimbra with Professor Ramos Silva and Dr. Pedro Pereira Silva, myself from the University of Zaragoza. And as a sort of brief introduction, I would like to discuss why we should incorporate a smartphone into our classes. So I will take a quote by Jay Cross, who passed away last year, who said that in spite of the fact that in general terms, I mean, we love our laptops, millennials are here in tablets and phones than in laptops. So we either be on board or we will end up missing train. So in terms of context, one question that arises is, why is the teaching of physics, of chemistry, of biology or geology at high school so theoretical? Why don't we have lab sessions or very few? The answer is usually the lack of resources. Having a lab session involves splitting the class into smaller groups, involves having more teachers or more hours per teacher, you need a space, you need equipment, you need labware, reagents. Everything is expensive in the long run, and you have to repair it. So, is there a way out to have some, we could say, interactive approach to those subjects without having to go to the lab? The answer is easy, the smartphones. I mean, most teenagers come to the class with a smartphone. And what do we do? At least, in my experience, most cases, it's what the previous presenter was saying. We say, put all the smartphones into this box or turn all the smartphones off during the class. It should be right the opposite. I mean, they are an excellent technological platform and the cost would be minimized. I mean, it would be almost zero. So we should try to incorporate them into our classes instead of asking the students to turn them off. And we will discuss an example of how to study projectile motion and determine the acceleration of gravity just by using a regular mid-range smartphone and a beach ball. I mean, it's better to use a beach ball or something which is big than one of those table tennis ones because it's easier to capture with a camera. So the idea is having a mid-range smartphone with a free burst camera APP and a common beach ball, and then either a printer and a ruler or using a computer with a free photo app. We are using you. So, is it that simple? Yes, actually it is. I mean, all the results that I will show were taken for the very first attempt, without repeating takes, without having a higher end sort of a smartphone, without taking care of focusing the camera, like our students would do. So it's sort of real data to work with. And the measurements involved would take something around 3, 4, up to 5 minutes. And we are talking of an experiment that, I mean, it's part of the curriculum all over the world. I mean, the law of inertia, the fundamental law of dynamics, it's something that everyone teaches. So it's easy to conduct experiment and to make it fit into our classes. The goal that the students deal with new technologies, smartphones and computers, that they learn physics, and of course that they enhance their logic skills. Methodology, what do we need to conduct the experiment? Well, we have used a Model G, a third generation one, which is roughly, I would say, in the price range of the smartphones that our students bring to the class. We are using a fast burst camera light, APP, it's the free version. For those who use, for example, an iPhone, they already have a burst APP inbuilt into the software. For those that use Android and that have a mid-range phone, this one works nicely and it's free. And then either we were saying a printer and a ruler or a computer with GIMP, which is open source, and OpenOffice because we will need to use Calc, which is equivalent to Microsoft Excel. Okay. So, in terms of results, we in this case, take photos for boat ocean. We'll be two experiments. So one of the students would be standing next to a wall and would toss a ball, and the other student would be 3-4 meters away and would use the burst camera app, would keep it the button pressed, and it would start collecting the movement of the ball. Sometimes it's blurry, but it's good enough, I mean, because you will see the more or less where the ball is located, even if there is some blur, and you can determine the position. It would look probably like this. And we can do two experiments in, as I was saying, less than 5 minutes. One would be the merely vertical drop. We just get the ball and let it drop and take photos while it's falling. And the other one is ball torsion, in which we'll have a combination of either the vertical movement and the horizontal one. So, if we get the data, I mean, we are using this reference axis, and you can see that in GIMP we have added over here a ruler. We use as a reference the height of the student or the teacher or the person who is conducting the experiment. So, in the first one, when we plot it, we just the free ball sort of data collection. It should be more or less like this, right? I mean, it's accelerated motion, the law of motion has its form. So when we go for a fit in Calcapy, we end up with a value for the gravity of 994. It's a good sort of value. It's not the right one, but we are close enough. And just as I was saying with the first set of pictures that we took. And what about the other one in which we will touch the ball? Okay, we end up with this sort of data in the x and y axis, and we split into two. On the one hand, the x axis movement, which would look more or less like this, a straight line, and that would be like that equation over there. And then again, the vertical axis that looks very similar to the previous one. And in this case, 974 meters per second. I mean, it's also a good approximation. So, in conclusion, we get nice values for the experiment. The experimental error would be below 2%, so it's nice. If instead of working with high school students, we want to move into A-level students, or we could say first or second year undergraduate students, we can add extra stuff. For example, instead of letting the ball fall, just we throw it upwards and then collect the photos for the upwards and downwards movement, and we could, for example, get the values for a resistance, which is nice, or to experimentally calculate the initial ball velocity and check the strength of each of the students. So it's very simple and free of charge, and something that we can easily do in all of our classes. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you.